Everybody, this is Pastor Christy. It is Sunday, May 2nd, 2021. Welcome to Worship with West Portland United Methodist Church, live from my living room in Beaverton, Oregon. And whenever and wherever you happen to be worshiping with us, know that we are grateful that you have joined us. And I'm going to invite you to join me in prayer. Gracious God, strong and mighty one, the sun is shining here in the Portland area today, and regardless of where, what the weather is outside, this love of your son always shines on us. And Lord, as we venture through our time of worship today, may we be reminded of that. May we sing of it. May we give you the glory and the honor. And as we share in this time of worship, may we also give thanks for all that you bless us with. Amen.
Holy, 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 high lifted up. shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you.
Good morning again, and I'm going to have you have to slide in a little bit more. We got to move this. Here we go. Hey, again, good morning. Pastor Christy here with West Portland UMC, and I have a guest this morning. This is Pastor Stephen Dillworth. If you've been at West Portland over the last few years, you have been blessed by him bringing the message when I have been out of town, but today we get to share in person. Whoop, whoop. And that's due large in part to what we're talking about. Also, the fact that what he does in his ministry, it's really fits in with what we are talking about today. And as a reminder of what can still happen ministry-wise during pandemic. So, Stephen, welcome. Glad you're here. And I also want to celebrate that he was making our communion pancakes while we were doing Sunday school. And so he's kind of a full service pastor. Yay. Anyway, today we're looking at the book of 1 John. This is like, it's really easy to skip if you're not paying attention. If you're like rushing to the book of Revelation, it's really easy to skip. There's three small books out here by John of Patmos, and they're some of the most powerful words. So what we're going to do is we're going to read the scripture, and then each of us are going to give some reflection. So we're going to break it in half. And Justin, I don't know how you have it printed, but just you will adapt as we read. I'm going to start with 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, and what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was rich with the Father and revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so our joy may be complete. Pray with me. Lord, may the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing unto you, our rock and our redeemer, the one who guides us, especially when we choose not to follow. Amen. So, Stephen, I didn't tell you, this is one of my all-time favorite passages of the Bible. And part of it is because I'm a multi-sensory person. And to me, this is five sensing Jesus. And the folks here are talking about how cool it was. Jesus came and visited, and they broke bread together. They hung out. They probably sang together. They did life. Mm-hmm. So it was really easy for them to say, we have seen, we have heard, we have touched. They, you know, they didn't shower a lot then, so it was probably a little odoriferous. And but they heard, and then they broke bread together. And they are so excited about this that they want to tell others. Now, the others, we'll get to a little bit more about that in a moment. But what I wanted to highlight is the importance that we can experience God with all five senses at all times. And that right there is reason to share our joy and for our joy to be complete by sharing that with others. Stephen, what does this passage do for you?
So, a lot. I love 1:1 especially. So one of the things that I'm kind of known for is I believe that God's a big boy or girl, but he's big enough to handle himself. So when I'm encountering people, I encourage them. I want to get to the point where they're thinking about God, but I don't feel like I have a need to tell them what to think about.
Ooh,
God.
Okay.
Right? I think God, once people are engaging in this idea that there is this sovereign deity, like, God is going to draw them, lead them, right? The Holy Spirit actually has a job to do, and the Holy Spirit's job is not my job.
Oh.
Right?
Really?
So, but this passage, when it's talking about the experiences too, right? So I do experiential education stuff through, like, high ropes courses, river rafting, rock climbing, adventure type stuff. Also through service opportunities, we have teams of from churches, youth groups, schools come down and actually serve. And then we facilitate the experience by asking really good questions. And as a trained facilitator, our job is not to come up with the best answers. Our job is to come up with the best questions that is going to get people to think and engage their own experience, right? So in this passage, we have this part, right? We're going to, from the beginning, which we have heard, and so we hear the stories of the gospel. We hear actual preaching, but we hear testimony through life, especially if we actually share life with people and we actually hear their stories in a natural sense, not this form of like, I am here to read my testimony. But as we engage with people, we will hear of the exploits of God interacting with man. And then I love this part too, because sometimes the Bible gets redundant and we wonder, like, was John just trying to fluff, add to his word count? But why is he repeating himself? So we have this two-part, right? That which we have seen, and then that which we have looked upon. And the difference in the Greek and the language is we see things, but at a point that it actually draws us closer, there's an intent and investigation. So you can walk down the street and you see a tree over in a park. But then to look upon it means you actually come further with an intent to investigate. Your curiosity is piqued, and so you'd go deeper and you look upon this. And then to actually touch it, right? To actually engage, whether that's serving, loving, whatnot. That's why, like, you can have a conversation about discipleship, but you put that same kid next to somebody in a soup kitchen while they're serving or cleaning up after people, and it's a whole different level of discipleship because they're touching, they're in the midst of actually doing And through that doing, we learn things.
Like being told about a fabulous meal versus actually eating the meal. You are experiencing it.
Right. Mm-hmm. You can smell it. You can look at it. You can watch somebody else eat it and see the joy that they have. But that's different from actually experiencing it for yourself. And that's the difference too, right? If I tell you what to think about God versus encouraging you to think about God.
Yeah.
Is the difference of me eating it versus you getting to taste it.
But also bringing along. And you work with Because People Matter. You've been with Youth Dynamics. You've pastored churches. And I've known Stephen through... when we met up in North Portland, we were both doing ministry up there, and we've both gotten involved in the community with Community Peace Collaborative and the Interfaith Peace Action Team. And Stephen has this amazing appearance to him, but if you sat long enough and visited with Stephen, you'd understand that there is a lot to him and his life. And we both have, he spends more time smack dab in the middle of opportunity for more danger, but Stephen doesn't shy away. And he was just sharing with me an incident recently, and where some of the volunteers were running away, which actually was a good idea and smart, but Stephen tends to run towards the opportunity. But he's equipped, he knows how to handle himself, but he also trusts God. He has this faith that he's not just going into it blindly and trying to be macho. So I just wanted to acknowledge that I see that in you. And that helps me in my faith to know that God calls us all to do different things. And there's times where I am tempted to step into it, but I also know sometimes God might pull me back, but not to be intimidated when God pushes you from behind.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's go on to our next part. Would you please read 5 through 10?
Absolutely. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in light, and he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. I think for me, I'll jump in first. I think there's a lot of danger when we try to keep things hidden from God, or even our community. And so I think sometimes we get this idea that, oh, in them there's no darkness. That means we have to be perfect. And therefore, the only thing we actually expose to the light is the perfect pieces of us. And we kind of keep these hidden things, the hidden darkness away. But the danger in that is that when things are brought to light, then God can work on them. Mm-hmm. Right? When things are brought into light, whether if I have anger issues, which I definitely had anger issues, whether I had drug issues in the past, oh wait, I've had those, arrested, my record, like I have a story. And if I kept all of that hidden, then I'm not working on it, but then God's not able to work on it. And it's not able to be shared with others who maybe have a similar story, and that those are barriers for them to their faith, or the barriers of them to getting healthy. But by bringing it all into light, doesn't mean like it doesn't exist, mm-hmm. but it means that there's no darkness around it, because I'm authentic with it. I'm transparent with it. I'm bringing it forward. That way God can use it, and we can share. And again, this ability to proclaim, like, I'm not there still, but God's done something through me. And this hindrance, and I just real quick, because this is John. And so John chapter 3, the famous passage, you know, for God so loved the world. After that, it talks about light, and this is what it says. All right, so John 3:19, and this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. And really it's just that piece of that fear of exposure. But it, right, God doesn't force himself into our lives. If we want to keep it hidden, he's going to let us hold on to that most of the time. But if we bring it, no matter how ugly it is, no matter how messy it is, no matter how broken it is, and we're like, hey, God, this is what I got. It's a bit messy. It's a bit broken. It's a bit shambled. God's like, right? I mean, what do we, like, redeemer, restorer, you know, new creation, makes things whole, healer. Like God is not going to be overwhelmed by any broken piece we bring forward to him as an offering and say, this is the muck of my life, but I want to bring it out, bring it in the light, and give it to you as an offering.
Amen. Amen. And the light and the dark. I love how you said that, you know, it's easy to assume that we can only bring to God our good. God gets bored if we only bring the good.
Right. Sometimes I think social media and Facebook, right? We post like our best stuff.
Oh, fake book?
Right. Yeah. So every once in a while on Facebook, this is actually, I'll go into my bathroom and like there's the pile of laundry and I just take a picture of my dirty laundry and I post it on social media. And just like as a, hey, I know I post like, here's the highlights, but I also like, this is
reality.
Real. Like part of my real life with all the messy pieces is dirty underwear on the bathroom floor. Right? Like that's part of, it's not just the perfect brought into the light. We're going to bring everything.
So this reminds me of when you go to the doctor when you're well. When you just go to check in and say, well, hello, Dr. Dillworth. I just want to let you know I'm doing great. You know, or you take your car to the mechanic when you don't have a problem. Or you go to the gym when you're already in shape. So this darkness and the light is that with God, there is no darkness. It's not that he shies away from it. It's that, and it also, it's not that we are alone in the darkness. That's one of the key pieces, Stephen, is I hear a lot of people thinking that God rejects me. I have to get in shape before I show up. Again, mm-hmm. I have to be in good health before I go to the doctor. My car has to be perfect before I take it to the mechanic, or those who clean the house before the maid comes, right? God is the one that's there to help us fix what's broken. And it's not a judgment that we might be given a prescription of, well, quit doing that. Start doing this. But it's not a judgment, folks. And when we read this part, 5 through 10, it's, again, it says it's almost a doublet because it says the same thing in a couple different ways. Is that if you say you don't have any sin, you're full of it. We are all full of sin, and we've all been sinful, yet if we have the fellowship with one another, we are all cleansed by Jesus. We are all encompassed in that love of what Jesus did for us on the cross. And it's also, it levels the playing field is one way to put it.
Yeah. Well, just, right, so if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. It doesn't mean the issue isn't there, right? It means that it's forgiven. God sees it. And yes, we still need to be working on it, whatnot, but it's not like all of a sudden I don't have an anger issue. It's that I show up and I have an anger issue, but God forgives it. Mm-hmm. And I'm able to press forward with him. And it's not making an excuse. I think there's, you know, we can get in a rabbit trail like, oh, well, you know, you need to work on, you know, sin and you should be improving. And do you just keep on sinning so that God's grace abounds, right? Like there's these debates that go around that. But God's forgiveness is in my brokenness is how he accepts me. Yes, he wants me to be better. Yes, he wants me to grow. Yes, he wants healing and restoration in my life. But that's not what he leads with. That's not the expectation.
Yeah.
The expectation is that we come broken and he will do something with it.
Oh, man. We'll do amazing things with those broken pieces. And as we transition into the five-sense experience of communion, that reminds us, folks, of how every day we can experience God with all five senses. Every day we can peek out of our darkness, sometimes self-imposed, sometimes it's what's going on around us. God is always with us. And then there's that reminder. There's that reminder of what Christ did for us. And it was on that last night, he was hanging out with his best buds. They were eating. There was the Last Supper. It was Passover. You know, this is what was going on. And we read that they were just hanging out after the meal. And then Jesus did something out of the ordinary. And he took a piece of bread. And they had something that was more flat bread. And he broke it. You know what he did, Stephen? He shared it. And he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." And he shared it with everybody around the table. They didn't really understand what this was about. But he continued with the mystery and he raised the cup. And he said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant. This is my love poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And you know, both of these are for the forgiveness of our sins. For Jesus reminded us that night, through those actions, that we are not perfect, but we are perfectly loved. We bring to God our brokenness, and we are made whole with that love. Pray with me, please. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon this bread and this wine, Lord. Make it be for us a reminder of your love for us. Make it be what holds us together, what binds our brokenness, what removes any of the gunk and the dirt that causes friction. We lift up our gratitude as we begin to receive. Amen. Amen. Stephen, the body of Christ broken for you, and the love of Christ poured out for you. And for the rest of you, in your own homes, know that whatever you have, it's the body of Christ broken for you and the love of Christ poured out for you. Amen.
One Lord.
one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Grain for the fields, scattered and grown, gathered to one for all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all. We are the blessing which we bless, and we, many throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord.
We are one body in this one Lord. Stephen, share with me one of your reflections about communion.
Yeah, so one of the things I like, just tying into our broken story here, is, you know, Jesus was fully aware that Judas was going to betray him. And yet Judas was still allowed to fellowship with them that evening. Yeah. And so even in the brokenness, even in the knowledge of that, Judas is permitted to be present. So don't keep, show up, right? Like, that's the thing. Keep showing up. Keep pressing into God no matter what state you're in. I so believe that God will reveal himself, even if you're unsure, even if you have doubts, even if you have guilt, even if you have shame. And maybe you have none of those things and you were just like, man, I'm good. What do I need God for? Like, even in your goodness, show up. Like, no matter what condition you find yourself, press into God and see what he will do, because I just believe he will always, always amaze us.
So you don't have to be perfect, yet if you're having a pretty decent day and you're doing pretty good, you can still show up?
Yeah.
Any condition, you can show up. Man, if that's not amazing grace, I don't know what is. I don't know what is. Stephen, thanks for sharing that. Wow. Absolutely. Wow. Let's go to God in prayer. We have some concerns and joys that have been posted. If you are on Facebook, you can put it in your comment section. If you are here on Zoom, you can put it in the chat. We've got a few already. Yes, and we'll start with Callie sharing that her teacher Anna is still not well and hasn't been able to be on Zoom school. But Callie also shared that during a bingo game last night, she won a shirt. Woohoo! Callie, the game master there. That's awesome. Prayers for Carol, Lisa's mom, as she adjusts to life in the memory care facility, and she still continues to heal from her fall. Lisa, we're still praying for you guys as well as you help your mom adjust. And folks, when you're lifting up Carol's name, also include that she be reminded that God is there with her, that even with the dementia, that that God can still get through to a way that she understands that God is there for her. And Justin asking for prayers, joy and a little sadness. He cleaned out his father's house yesterday and got taken care of. His father's still alive. He's just moved. But still, that is the end of an era. And Justin, we also just give prayer of thanks for how amazing, what an amazing son you have been and all that you have done for your dad as well. What other joys and concerns? Those who are not yet vaccinated and when we enter, a prayer for all of us, when we enter conversations with people who haven't received it or choose not to, and the decisions that we have to make sure we stay safe and they stay safe as well.
Yeah, can I share the BPM news? So
yeah.
Because people matter, we have just been going deeper with people and received a large donation to be able to hire a part-time social worker.
Amen.
To accompany us in our outreach work that we do. And so we're looking for the right person, the right fit. It's a part-time gig, but we have a culture. There's like values that we try to live out as an organization. We just really want to find the right person to fit and gel with our mission, vision, team, culture,
man,
the work. So
they need to be a licensed social worker.
They don't have to be. Ideally, we want, kind of in my mind, I'm looking for a savvy veteran social worker who's kind of semi-retired but comes with some experience and can kind of guide and speak into some of our volunteers.
We just pray for that person to come forward. If that sounds like anybody you know, you can get a hold of Stephen. You can just email the church office and we can get everybody connected. I also want to lift up a joy with a little bit of sorrow. Betty Foster is moving into her new place this weekend. That's why she's not with us this morning. She has a beautiful cottage in Tualatin. We'll be sharing her new address and phone number in the All Church email on Tuesday. But she wanted everybody to know that even though she's leaving the home she's been in since 1965, she's excited about her new place and her new space and that she will have time to enjoy it. All right. Yes, Mike, we will continue to pray for your sister, Linda, who fell off a ladder. And she has 9 fractures now. Not just 7, she has 9. Oh, heavens. And definitely want to lift up your daughter, Carrie, who's having her hernia surgery tomorrow. I know that she's been awaiting for this to happen. We are grateful that this is able to take place, and for you guys who wrap around her family with love and support. What other joys and concerns might we have that we want to share with one another?
Well, I did get both of my shots about a month ago.
Yes, Earl. All right. Yeah.
I'm good for in that area.
And you're feeling okay.
Yeah, man. The neighbors are awesome around here.
And the move has still been good. I'm glad to hear that, Earl. That's fabulous.
We're in a new relationship now, but we're taking it one day at a time.
One day at a time. That's, you know, that's all we can do, Earl. I don't know how you live 2 days at once anyway, but when
we jump into it, I learn from my mistakes.
Earl, did you see who we have today?
Yes, Stephen. Good morning.
Wow. Hey, folks, I also want to ask that you lift up, keep in your prayers our community.
She did give me a promise ring, though. So, you know, that means we're going together, but trusting each other that we won't do whatever.
All right, Earl. Well, we'll continue to pray for this new relationship, that you guys take it slow and get to know yourselves and each other in that, so it's a healthier and good experience for you. Folks, I also ask you to continue to pray for our community. Everybody, pray for those who are in a role that their job requires them to show up where there's conflict, and pray for each and everybody in our community that the conflict doesn't rise to a point where there is intervention by law enforcement, by community action. May we all help keep each other in a good path, and may we all be there for one another and be more concerned and interested about what happens before someone picks up a gun to deal with a problem. You know, the latest chart, we have not gone for more than 24 hours without a shooting. And this is not hunting. This is not that. This is an act of violence towards self, towards others. And folks, if we sit back and sit silent, we're saying it's okay. There's a lot of folks out there that a kind word, an acknowledgement, is the only thing that stands between their pain and their trauma and them causing more pain and trauma. So show up, folks, show up. And also just prayers for those in transition. I mean, it's spring, our allergies are kicking our keisters. And for those who will be moving, going off to college, we've got a couple graduates, one that lives in this house, and a lot of transition coming up, folks. Please join me in prayer. God, thank you. God, thank you so much. As we read this morning during Sunday school from Psalm 92, we continue to praise you. We continue to praise you from morning to night. We praise you with our music, with our hearts. We give thanks that you stand with us no matter what, that you stand with us, Lord, in our darkest of darks. You are there with us, Lord. When we close those prison doors on our own lives, our own opportunities, our own minds, Lord, you are there with us and reminding us that there is no lock. There is no lock, Lord, that we have the freedom to open those up. And that freedom comes from having that relationship with you, inviting you into our darkness and our brokenness, Lord, and for us to receive that we are okay just as we are. That to be able to come to you vulnerable, to be able to come with you with our joys, with our concerns, Lord, brings you delight. You want that interaction, Lord. Thank you for not being a God of judgment and condemnation, Lord. For in you there is no condemnation. There is love. There is grace. There is mercy. There is justice and compassion. And when we allow ourselves to come forward and allow you and the Holy Spirit to clean out the gunk and the muck, Lord, is when we can truly delight in you as well. Lord, thank you for understanding our prayers, those that we speak, those that weigh heavy on our hearts that we don't have words for. Lord, thank you for shining your love and your mercy into our lives, for giving us the tools of fellowship, for giving us the tools of technology that we can connect, for giving us the tools of prayer, like the one that your Son taught us, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, good still continues to happen. We're still able to do mission and ministry, and the opportunities are always present. Stephen is here with Because People Matter, and one of our first mission moments. I want to remind you that you can support BPM. If you want to do boots on the ground, they have COVID safe ways of serving. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so bpmpdx.org is the website, and there's volunteer signups there. You just go and you can look and sign up for Sunday walkabouts, where we actually walk about distributing resources out of wagons, and then night strike. So far the city and county has been very impressed with our practices, our policies to keep everybody safe. We're limited number of people into the resource area. Everybody's masked up. We're temping everybody, doing a screening check before they're allowed in. And that's for both our guests we're serving as well as all of our volunteers. So far we've been really good and have been able to maintain throughout this whole season and keep being there. And right, so our goals, COVID has been hard, but we've committed through this time. Like, we're gonna show up, we're gonna serve well, and we're gonna do the best that we can. And that looks different each day, but I, for myself, when I go to bed at night, I need to know I did those three things. We showed up, we served well, we did the best that we could, whether we served a lot or a little, whether we had a lot of resources to distribute or a little, just all that aside, did we show up? Yes.
Fabulous.
Did we serve well? Yes. Did we do the best that we could?
BPMPDX.org.
Yep.
Okay. And we will put a reminder link in this on the website as well as our Facebook page. Justin, make a note for that, please. And you can also, you can donate to them your time and your talent and your treasure. And a couple of years ago, West Portland UMC, for one of our family nights unplugged, we filled a whole bunch of little bottles of shampoo and lotion and conditioner and soap and stuff. And we got the unofficial award for having the best ones because we labeled them.
They were labeled. They were neat. They were organized. You guys did amazing. You can do it again, because I was told by our director of relief, like, oh, we would love that again. So, you know, that's so, something you guys can do from home to still support us on the street.
Right. We have the gallons of the stuff, and we have some of the containers. If this is of interest to you, message the church office and we can do an at-home thing, because that is something you can sit at home and you can pump out of a gallon container into like a 2-ounce container. And you are being boots on the ground. You are equipping Stephen and his folks that are boots on the ground. Okay, Armin Trouts. We've already got one family ready to do it. Woo, all right, Armin nice. Trouts. Anyone else want to commit to that? Anyone else want to commit? You can do it now. You can commit later. We will equip you and make sure that you have what you need to do it. And that is one way we can be active in mission and ministry. Doesn't require any skill. Doesn't require any knowledge. You don't have to take a test. You just have to be able to hold a bottle and pump stuff into one thing and put a label on it. Yeah.
It's perfect. Thank you.
Man, that is something we take for granted. We take for granted our soap and our shampoo and our lotion or anything like that. But to not have showered for weeks, maybe even a month, and to be given the gift of something like that makes all the world difference. I mean, the difference in the world. It shows that they're human.
Yep.
Yeah, it shows that they're human. We also have coming up the Little Library, folks. This is a great mission and ministry opportunity. Peggy, are you on? And did you get any of the research done yet, or do we want to just put that out Tuesday? All right, we'll put it out Tuesday. I've done the if you go to littlelibrary.org, the closest one to the church is over a half mile away. And we have such a pedestrian-friendly neighborhood, even though it's a little dangerous on those streets, on Taylor's Ferry. We have people that walk around all the time that love little libraries. And the picture on the right is the beginning of ours. Stephanie Millar set that up to begin with, and she had some help with Lori and Joy. But it's hidden. People can't see it. So it's a great little library. It's just not available. So this would be an ongoing ministry. It would be a one-time investment to get the little library box built and put in. And then, which I know you guys can do easily. And then you rotate, and this is something that anyone can be part of, is to make sure that it is supplied with good materials. And know that people are going to walk by, and I know a lot of people that use little libraries. So it is a very easy, low-hanging fruit mission opportunity for the church. So Peggy's done a lot of our stuff, but if this is something of interest for you, please speak up. Let us know in the office. All right, and the last bit, Light of the Tunnel. This is an event coming up on May 19th through Ecumenical Ministries of Oregon. You guys have heard me talk so much about the importance of our stories. And you've heard me also say that we're all in the same storm, but we're not in the same boat. This Light in the Tunnel is a series of gathering stories about survival during the pandemic. And I bet you will hear some familiar things, but you might also find ways that you can celebrate what you've done. All right, Callie wants to help out with Little Library. That's awesome. Thank you, Callie. All right. And then I want to remind you that our offering plate looks a little different right now. We have a digital offering plate. You can send a check directly to the church. You can give online just by going to our website. And you can also text to give. And folks, just a reminder that this is not an obligation. This is an act of worship. It is actually a beautiful invitation to give God what's right, not what's left. And my challenge for you is, how is God asking you to grow in your giving this week? As we prepare for our final hymn, I just want to say thank you, Stephen. It's always a pleasure to share the word with you, to hear more. Even though we have several things in common, we do have a few things on which we're at a different angle. But as brothers and sisters in Christ, we are able to come together in the word and share in that delight. And I just want to say thank you so much for that as well. Hey, Eric, you ready for our closing hymn?
Yes.
Sweet.
Something beautiful, something good. Oh my God. confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life. But he made something beautiful of my life.
Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you, man, just thank you that we've been able to set aside whatever else is going on in our world, in our space, so we can just pause and give you the glory. We can pause and say thank you. We can pause and say, God, I don't feel worthy. God, I just am so confused. Lord, I got stuff that I might be ashamed of. But Lord, thank you for receiving us, no matter what condition we are in. Thank you for receiving us with your love, your grace, your mercy, your justice, and your compassion. Thank you for giving us now and tomorrow, and that hope that no matter what goes on, no matter what our tomorrow looks like, Lord, you are there with us. Lord, thank you for this time to gather, to lift up your name through song, prayer, and word. And thank you for sending your Son to love us, to forgive us for our sins, and for the act of the sacrament of communion, that we can be reminded that we are loved, we are worthy, and we are forgiven. Amen.
Amen.
And I invite all of you to join us in our spoken benediction. Do not be dismayed by the brokenness of the world. All things break, and all things can be mended. Not with time, as they say, but with intention. So go, love intentionally, extravagantly, unconditionally. The broken world waits in darkness for the light that is you. Amen and amen.
Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.